Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one, I call Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will reconsider its decision to pause capital funding for NHS Highland in respect of completion of the refurbishment of Granton Health Centre in light of reports that these works were nearly completed and that the pause of the contract may lead to additional costs in excess of the notional sum saved.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Based on the latest forecast, our block grant for capital is expected to reduce in real terms by 8.7% by 2027-28, a cumulative loss of over £1.3 billion. This has had an inevitable effect and led to some difficult decisions in common with all health capital investment projects in development, and the Granton Health Centre Phase 2 has been paused at this stage until the necessary capital funding becomes available.
Fergus Ewing.
The Cabinet Secretary is aware that there is a cross-party campaign supported by myself, Ed Mountain and Rhoda Grant. It's a non-political campaign that the cost of the project is £2.4 million. But unlike every other project in NHS Highland, this project is nearly completed. £2 million of the £2.4 have actually been incurred. And the materials are on site waiting to be installed. But if there is not an overturn of the decision within the next 3 weeks, abortive costs will be incurred, which, together with the running costs of the old Victorian Ian Charles building, which was to be decommissioned, will mean that the overall cost will far exceed the notional savings. So will the Cabinet Secretary, whom we met yesterday and whose willingness to listen was much appreciated, seriously reconsider that a small sum of £400,000 would help to save this vital project promised the community nearly a decade ago?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I thank Fergus Ewing for his question and for both his engagement, that of Edward Mountain and Rhoda Grant, and indeed the Granton on Spey medical practice and NHS Highland, whom, as he says, met with me yesterday to discuss the situation. I'm very grateful for the further information that's been provided across all of those participants in that meeting, and I gave a commitment yesterday that I would, without prejudice, without any commitment, look to go away and consider the position and the potentially exceptional situation that there is there, and I committed to come back to those that were on the meeting as soon as I possibly could.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I too am pleased to be working with Rhoda Grant and Fergus Ewing. The 2015 redesign of healthcare in Strathspey and Badenoch required the closure of two hospitals and an upgrade of two GP practices, including the Granton practice. The non-completion of the Granton medical practice, which was the last piece in the jigsaw, will leave this government and NHS Highland without one shred of credibility in Speyside. Could I ask the Cabinet Secretary to reflect on that when he's making his decision?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I thank Edward Mountain to be reiterating a point that he raised with me yesterday. And of course, that will be part of the consideration in this case. And I look to take a swift decision, either positive or negative, as quickly as possible.
Thank you. Question number two, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is supporting the museum sector.
Minister Cocap-Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government provides significant support to the museum sector and will continue to do so. For example, we have given cultural bodies an uplift in 2024-25, which includes National Museum Scotland. We continue to support the National Development Body for Scotland's museum sector, Museums Galleries Scotland, and we have committed to provide an uplift of £800,000 to the V&A Dundee. This despite the Scottish Government's challenging 2024-25 budget position, and I'm pleased that our investment continues to support our museums and world-class collections, ensured that they are cared for and enjoyed by everybody across Scotland.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank the Minister for her response. I'm sure she will want to join with me in welcoming the opening this week of the new Perth Museum, a fantastic new resource created by Perth and Kinross Council with the assistance of £10 million from the UK Government by way of the Tay Cities deal, and of course home now to Scotland's Stone of Destiny. So will the Scottish Government, how will the Scottish Government help Perth and Kinross Council capitalise on the economic and cultural opportunities offered by this new museum?
Minister.
I thank Marjo Fraser for raising that, and I am very pleased that Perth Museum will reopen on the 30th of March after a significant redevelopment project. Alongside the Stone of Destiny, the museum houses the Perth and Kinross recognised collections of national significance, as well as being situated in one of Scotland's heritage buildings. As you know, Perth Museum will be managed in partnership with Perth and Kinross Council and Culture Perth and Kinross, and was supported by City Regions Deal, which received funding from the Scottish Government alongside other partners, including the UK Government and regional partners. As mentioned, the Scottish Government continues to provide funding to the National Development Body for Scotland's museum sector, MGS, who provide valuable strategic investment, advice, workforce development and advocacy.
Question number three, Ash Regan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, how many children aged 16 and under have been prescribed puberty-suppressing hormones by NHS Scotland since 2014.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, President Officer. The Sandyford Young People's Gender Service, based in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, offers a range of support to young people and their families. Referral to paediatric endocrinology for consideration for endocrine intervention is only one potential option of the overall clinical pathway offered. According to figures provided by NHS Scotland, from 2016 to December 2023, just under 100 young people aged 16 or under were referred by the Sandyford Clinic to paediatric endocrinology in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and NHS Lothian for further assessment for puberty blockers. Not all of those referred would have been assessed as suitable to progress onto this medication. I understand NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde are currently reviewing their data systems, and I shall write to Ash Regan with the relevant information for the 2014 to 2016 period when available.
Ash Regan.
Following medical evidence reviews, Denmark, Finland, Norway, Sweden, France and England now sharply restrict or prohibit the use of puberty blockers for gender dysphoria. There is weak to no proof that they help, but there is much evidence of serious side effects. They prevent bone density development, they render children infertile, they can cause damage to the heart and cause severe depression. Class action lawsuits in the US, courts now involving thousands of patients damaged by puberty blockers. So what will it take for this government to step in and protect Scotland's children from this unethical experiment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. We're aware of the new clinical policy that has recently been issued by NHS England on the routine prescription of puberty-suppressing hormones for children and young people as a treatment option for gender dysphoria. The details of this are being closely considered by NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and its relevant clinical team as the provider of the Young People's Gender Service at Sandyford. Any decision on how such healthcare is delivered in Scotland will rightly be made by health boards and their clinicians. It should also be noted that NHS England's announcements follow their interim policy position last year, recommending puberty blockers are only accessed via a research programme it is establishing. So the Scottish Government and NHS Scotland remain observers to this study development, and we're considering what further engagement may be appropriate.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The cash review was clear in its recommendations, and given the action taken in Scotland was on the basis of lack of evidence that these puberty-suppressing hormones were safe or effective, many in Scotland will be expecting action from government. Can I ask the Health Secretary what actual discussion he's had with NHS Scotland in light of the decision taken in England? And if action is to be taken, what timescales for such action, and will he set this out to Parliament?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Carol Mockin for her question. We've been consistently clear that the ongoing findings of the CAS review and the review's final report, once published, will be and are being considered closely by both the Scottish Government and NHS Scotland in the context of how such healthcare is best delivered here in Scotland. And while the CAS review obviously only extends to NHS England services, Scottish Government officials and NHS Scotland clinicians have met with Dr Cass on multiple occasions to share information on improvement work in Scotland and expected outcomes of that review ongoing.
Thank you. We have much to get through, colleagues. Concise questions and responses appreciated. At question number four, I call Maggie Chapman.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to support the mental well-being of asylum seekers accommodated in hotels in Scotland.
Minister Marie Todd.
The Home Office is responsible for the provision of asylum accommodation and support, including the use of contingency hotels. The Scottish Government has consistently made clear to the UK Government that hotels are not appropriate accommodation, and we continue to be concerned about the effect prolonged stays in hotels have on people's well-being. People seeking asylum living in Scotland are entitled to access healthcare, including referral to mental health services. The Scottish Government funds a range of action that supports mental health and wellbeing, which is available to anyone living in Scotland, regardless of their resident status.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for that response. She will be aware of the overwhelming evidence of worsening mental health among hotel-accommodated asylum seekers. There have been at least 5 suicide attempts in the last few months. Asylum seekers don't feel safe. They feel like they are in open prisons. The Ferret and the Scottish Refugee Council identify the rise in far-right hostility and the fact that about 500 asylum seekers have to share bedrooms with strangers as contributing factors. How can the Scottish Government and public agencies, including the NHS, mitigate the impacts of these measures and provide increased safety, reassurance and mental health support to people seeking asylum?
Minister.
So we absolutely recognise that the circumstances and the uncertainty that asylum seekers and refugees face, which is often distressing and can lead to an increased risk of suicide. In implementing the Scottish Government and COSLA's suicide prevention strategy, Creating Hope Together, we're working hard to tackle the inequalities that can lead to suicide, as well as prioritising communities and groups where there's a heightened risk of suicide, which includes asylum seekers and refugees. To improve the mental health and well-being of our asylum seekers and refugee community, we're engaging with public sector partners, including the NHS. We're also connecting with existing projects supporting asylum seekers and refugees, such as Mental Health Foundation's Elevate project. We also continue to fund the Simon Community Scotland, who are doing excellent work in supporting asylum seekers and people with no recourse to public funds. And our partnership this year is delivering peer support for people living in Glasgow, which has been developed to meet specific needs of that community. More widely...
Thank you, Minister. I do need to move on to the next question. At question number five, I take Ariane Burgess.
To ask the Scottish Government for an update on the Cost of Living Tenant Protection Scotland Act 2022.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Emergency Act has provided tenants with extra protection and stability at a time when rents have been rising across the UK, but as Parliament agreed, it must come to an end on the 31st of March. All rent increase notices issued until the 1st of April still need to comply with the cap, as well as giving 3 months' notice, and from that date on, we know that many landlords will continue to act responsibly. However, without action, there could be cases where tenants face sudden extreme rent increases. So I am pleased that Parliament recently approved regulations to temporarily modify the rent adjudication process by which tenants can ask for a review of rent increases. This will protect tenants by preventing a cliff edge as we transition out of the emergency legislation while continuing to support responsible landlords.
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the Minister for that response. Over the 18 months of the emergency rent cap, the number of privately rented properties on the public landlord register has grown by more than 5,000, despite attempts by landlord groups and some opposition MSPs to claim the opposite. So, with the Minister publishing a bill yesterday which delivers much of the new deal for tenants in the Bute House Agreement, including new rights for tenants and long-term rent controls, how does he think the proposals should be greeted by responsible landlords who want to provide a good and fair service?
Minister.
Well, the member is right that private renting has always been a very dynamic sector, some landlords leaving and others entering, and the evidenced growth of registered properties available for private rent over the last 18 months demonstrates this further. I do acknowledge that there are some limitations to that data. There could be a time lag in landlords deregistering properties, for example, but a fairer, well-regulated private rented sector is in the interests of both tenants and responsible landlords and can be attractive to investors. So our proposals will help to improve affordability for tenants in the private rented sector while recognising the importance of landlords investing in the quality of property.
Question number six, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what action it is taking to support tenants in light of accelerating rents.
Minister.
Well, as I said in the answer to the last question, the Cost of Living Act has provided tenants with much needed stability within tenancies at a time when rents have been rising across the UK. And in 2023-24, we also invested over £83 million in discretionary housing payments, a vital tool to reduce poverty, safeguard tenancies and prevent homelessness. I'm also delighted that the new housing bill has now been introduced, as set out in the programme for government. This bill will enable the delivery of our commitment for longer-term proposals for private rented sector rent controls, strengthen tenants' rights and other protections, and duties aimed at the prevention of homelessness.
Katie Clark.
I welcome the publication of the Housing Scotland Act and congratulate Living Rent, tenants' unions and all who have campaigned for rent controls legislation. As the Minister knows, we face a housing emergency, and the Minister has referred to concern about a cliff edge. The adjudication system being proposed by the Scottish Government is complicated, and there is concern about the burden on councils. Living Rent is calling for a rent cap. What consideration is being given to interim measures to help tenants whilst we wait for the legislation to come into force?
Minister.
Well, I join the member in congratulating all those who've campaigned for progress in this area for a long time, as indeed have I. I first proposed rent controls well over a decade in this Parliament and got very little support at that time from any part of the political spectrum. I'm very glad that the case has much more support today. But the member is also aware that the temporary emergency legislation that this Parliament passed did have that time limit. If it had not had that time limit, if it had not been temporary emergency legislation, it would have failed the legal test of proportionality and necessity, which we have to do. The legislation was challenged in court, and the large reason that we won that challenge was that we met that proportionality and necessity test by the temporary nature of emergency legislation. The adjudication provisions that we've made are more complicated than a rent cap by necessity, but we put a great deal of effort into raising awareness of tenants' rights and making sure that they're able to exercise the rights and protections that are available to them.
Question number 7, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many children in Aberdeen have been lifted out of poverty since the inception of the Scottish Child Payment.
Minister Paul McLennan.
It's estimated that the Scottish Child Payment will keep 60,000 children in Scotland out of poverty in 24-25, but this impact cannot be broken down to local authority area level. However, published statistics show that over 327,000 children in low-income families in Scotland were receiving the Scottish Child Payment in December 23, with over 10,000 of these children in Aberdeen City. Since the launch of the Scottish Child Payment, over £570 million in payments have been made to the families who need it most in Scotland, with over £18 million of these payments being made in Aberdeen City alone.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's gratifying that the Scottish Child Payment has contributed to lifting 100,000 children in Scotland out of poverty. Has the Scottish Government had any discussion with the UK Government about whether they will replicate the scheme south of the border, as possible Barnett consequentials for Scotland could help us do even more to lift people out of poverty here?
Minister.
Yeah, we have repeatedly called on the UK Government to make key changes to reserve benefits, including to introduce an essentials guarantee and to reverse damaging welfare cuts, such as the two-child limit, steps which would lift 40,000 children out of poverty in Scotland next year. The First Minister also wrote to Keir Starmer in January to find ways of working together to tackle poverty, should Labour form the next UK Government. No reply has been received from either Labour or the current UK Government, and neither have indicated any intention to match ambitious anti-poverty measures taken here in Scotland.
Brief supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
The Minister points to the impact of the child payment rightly, but does he accept that on last week's poverty and inequality statistics and the budgetary decisions of his government, including slashing the housing and employability budgets, that IPPR, Save the Children and the Joseph Rowntree Foundation have said that the interim poverty targets are now at risk or are going to be missed? Does he agree with those experts?
Minister.
Yeah, we will continue to do all within our powers to reduce child poverty, but also to mitigate the ingrained austerity of successive UK governments. And I'll come back to the point that I just mentioned previously in the previous answer to Kevin Stewart. We've written to Keir Starmer in that regard in terms of what he's currently saying, and we've had no answers back.
Let's hear the Minister.
So, and the other point I think is very important. In contrast, the UK government has scrapped its child poverty target, for example, in 2016 and has continued its campaign of austerity.
And if he wants to talk about comparing records, in January, children's groups, along with the Welsh Children's Commissioner, criticised the Welsh Labour-run government for failing to set targets.